Hello everybody, this is Manu S, back with the next part of the Artifact Set Review. Today it's time to talk about the Black Reaps, so let's dive right in. Okay, so first off we have Assassin's Apprentice. This might look a bit underwhelming due to the fact that it is a 3-2 and doesn't even beat a melee creep, but that's not its purpose. Thanks to its ability that can be used once a turn, you can choose a combat target for Assassin's Apprentice, which makes it great for sort of, yeah, ganking or flanking opposing units. You can use this to either finish off a creep on turn one that is facing your own creep, or if you're lucky, you can even use it to finish off an opposing hero. In Limited, this is a very nice black creep, something that you can pick fairly highly, not like super high, but it is a good card. And in Constructed, I'm not sure if this has a place in Constructed, but it might, at least in like very aggressive decks, because of the flexibility it provides. Next we have a Glody Catapult. Well, this card is just terrible, honestly, if you ask me. This card is effectively a 2-4, so effectively a 2-cost melee creep, except that it is a lot worse than a melee creep, basically. First of all, it doesn't deal damage the turn it comes down. It deals 2 piercing damage to the enemy tower before the action phase, so the next turn. So you're already down 2 damage. Then it has no attack, which means if something lands in front of it, it just kills it for free. Even a melee creep kills it over 2 turns. So even if you can put it in an empty spot, it's gonna deal like 4 damage to the tower and then die for free. That's just a pretty bad rate. This is basically worse than Trebuchet, like, significantly, if you ask me. And yeah, it's just, the card is just so bad. The floor is so low, and the ceiling is also pretty low. The card is just not good. And in Constructed, it's even worse. Just don't play this in any format, really. Next, we have Untested Grunt. Initially, I thought the card is pretty bad, but the more I played, I think the card is quite decent. Your deck has to be aggressive, but if your deck is aggressive, this guy is actually pretty solid, because you don't care too much about fighting creeps, so you're usually just gonna deploy this in an empty spot, usually even hope that it doesn't flank, so you get like 4 damage on the tower right away, start the race early, and then you can support it with stuff like Assault Letters, Disciple of Nevermore, the Oath, and so on, to just run down a lane pretty quickly. Effectively, like, if you would look at it from like Magic terms, for example, this is like a 1 mana 2-2 effectively, because it's like a turn 1 play that deals 10% of the opponent's life total and damage. So yeah, it is a pretty solid creep, and it can even end up making it in Constructed for the same reason, to just kind of raise, because dropping a 4 attack creep on turn 1 can be really important if aggression is the name of the game. But yeah, outside of dedicated aggressive decks, I think the card is barely playable. Next we have Disciple of Nevermore, one of the staples of black, especially common staples. It's a 3-cost 4, minus 2, 4, that gives all your allies in the lane plus 2 attack and minus 2 armor, which is super powerful. This is obviously also meant for racing, for killing towers, and not so much for fighting. You can sometimes also use it to win fights and kill stuff, but it makes a lot of stuff trade, usually, so it's better when your stuff is not being blocked and you just race down the tower. This is also really good at helping you to deal AD and kill an Ancient in a lane, or just deal 4D super fast. Card is a super high pick in Limited, one of the best non-hero picks in black, I would argue. And in Constructed, this is also a potential staple in aggressive black base decks. Next we have a Glody Vandal, basically Artifacts Viashino, I don't remember the full name, the 2-mana 2-1 that deals 2 damage to the enemy player when it comes into play. This is like the artifact equivalent. It's a turn 2 play, it deals 10% of the enemy health in as a summon, as a play effect, and then has attack stats that also reflect that and deal 10% of the opponent's health. And yeah, it also fights pretty well against melee creeps, which is a plus, so it can You can put it in front of one, kill it, and then hope that it just keeps smashing the tower afterwards. You can also just plop it down in an empty spot and use it as a better untested grunt. And yeah, the fact that it deals 4 direct damage can be really helpful when the opponent is about to stabilize, stalling you out in that last critical lane, and then you just plop down an Oglody Vandal or two and just finish them off. It's a very solid limited card. The more aggressive your deck is, the higher the value of these. If you are like a dedicated red-black or blue-black aggressive deck, this might become a really high pick. Otherwise, it's just a solid pick because there are a lot of fours competing for the slot, and other colors often have better four-cost cards. Anyway, in constructed, dedicated aggressive decks, love this card. Outside of that, it's probably not gonna make it in constructed. Next, we have Pit Fighter of Quoit. Another 4-drop, this time a rare. It's a 2/8, and it gets +2 attack after an allied neighbor dies. Card is not that exciting, but it's decent. Basically, you want in limited, you want to put this down when something is about to die to make sure that it is at least a 4/8 out of the gate. And if you manage to do that, a 4/8 for 4 is actually really good. But if you don't manage that, the card is pretty underwhelming. So it's a bit situational, but it's not super hard to set up. So it is a very solid 4-drop. It's a bit less good in very aggressive decks, I would say, for the reason that it can sometimes be a 2/8, and it also kind of can force you to deploy it in a specific lane where stuff dies, so it is less flexible. But it is pretty solid. You can still play it, but don't pick it too highly. And in a not-so-aggressive deck, its value goes up, because then the high health and the more defensive nature, the more defensive potential have more value than in an aggressive deck. Next we have Ravenous Mass. That's a bit of an oddball, literally, because, you know, it's kind of a ball of corpses. You can activate it once a turn to eat its allied neighbors, and it gets their attack and health. The problem is that this eats a lot of resources, puts all your eggs in one basket. It also means that if the things you're eating have armor, that armor is lost. But yeah, it can kind of snowball on the opponent, but it is a pretty high-risk card, and I think usually it is better to just leave it on the bench in limited and in constructed. I don't see this card being worthwhile or getting any better in the future. I don't think there's much to discover. The card is just gimmicky and underpowered. Okay, next we have Tyler Estate Center. That card is about as great as the Tyler Estate is bad. First off, we get a 4-cost 2/8, great defensive unit, very durable body, and the enemy tower has -1 mana. Due to the fact that -1 mana is applied immediately, unlike, for example, in Eternal, where that wouldn't be the case, you want to have initiative in the lane you play this, and then you just play it on curve and deny the opponent your first play. A lot of decks don't play much on turn 1, and then on turn 2 they have a ton of plays, because there's usually so many 4-cost cards in most decks, and if you then play this, the opponent just gets time walked. They will usually not be able to spend their mana and progress their board in that lane, which is very powerful. Both in limited and constructed. I think it goes down a bit in aggressive decks, especially in limited. In constructed, the tempo gain from the -1 mana makes up for the lack of aggressive stats, I think, because there's like more curving and high quality plays and dedicated deck building going on. So the -1 mana and taking the second turn from the opponent has more impact, where in limited the opponent might not make do something as powerful, or might sometimes not even do anything at all, and so on. So the effect of the -1 mana is a bit higher variance. It's still really strong, don't get me wrong, but I think it is even stronger in constructed. So yeah, this is a pretty high pick in limited and a nice constructed card. Next we have Sister of the Veil, the big sister of Assassin's Apprentice, the teacher, so to speak. She's a 4/5 for 5. That's pretty decent. Also keep in mind there is a notorious lack of 5-cost cards or 5-drops, especially 5-cost creeps in limited usually, because a lot of the stuff is on like 4 and 6 and 8. So 5, you're always happy to find solid 5s to fill out your curve. And this is a particularly good 5. It fights creeps well. It can flank heroes. It can flank bigger creeps with its ability. It's pretty durable. Just a very robust card. Reasonably high pick and limited. About on the level or above something like Oglody Vandal. Probably a bit above and a bit below like Tyler Estate Sensor. That sort of stuff. I might do like a pick order for commons and non-commons of each color at some point, since including rares and pick orders doesn't make much sense. You don't see them that often. And commons and uncommons of each color are the bread and butter of your drafting, and they also determine how deep a color is. So like how many players it can support, how likely you are to get enough good cards on an average draft from that color and so on. But yeah, that is for a later day. Next we have Ravenhook. Another pretty underwhelming black creep. It's a 6 cost 3/6. You can use it once a turn. You can demon a random item equipped by the unit blocking Ravenhook, and then you get gold equal to the base cost of that item. The one neat thing that you can do that someone pointed out to me on stream the other day that I didn't quite think of, because the card overall honestly is too bad for me to think about much. I just don't want to have this in my deck really. And even with that application, I don't really want to. But if you end up with it in your deck, it will matter to you. And what you can do is you can use it on a hero. If the hero has a health item and has less health than the health item, gives it health, then the hero will just die if you destroy it. Like, for example, the opponent has a hero with like 2, 3, or 4 health, or even 1 health. Just put this in front, activate it, and then the hero just dies. And a lot of the time, heroes only have one item, which is a health item, so the random part of the ability is not that big of a problem. So that's nice. It can kill heroes. But aside from that situationally powerful use, you get a pretty overcosted, understated creep that is pretty situational and even has to have a free hero spot to go into to have any meaningful impact. It's kind of like a blue hero without all the upside of the good signature cards. And last but not least, we have Assassin's Shadow. It is a 7 cost 15/5 with Siege 5 and has minus 2 attack for each ally, which means each other ally. It doesn't shrink itself, of course. So, yeah, this is quite good. You can put it in a fairly empty lane to deal a ton of damage and run down a tower really fast, alongside like a creep and maybe a hero. Then this hitting for 11, kind of like another Solar Karn or Bounty Hunter that won the die roll. And even if it's blocked, it has Siege 5 almost as much as a Thunderhide pack and lives through like 2 melee creeps. So even if there are like a bunch of melee creeps landing in front of it, you're still getting a pretty solid deal. Card is not insane, but it is a pretty good pickup for an aggressive deck and draft, and in Constructed I don't think it's gonna do it. It's just a bit too fragile and yeah, clunky, and there are just better options to finish games. So yeah, I wouldn't put my hopes on this in Constructed, but in Limited this is a pretty nice top end for aggressive decks. Okay, this already concludes the review of the Black Creeps. Tomorrow I will be back with the Red Spells, and then we'll go through all the spells of each color in the next 4 days. And then we are on to the improvements and the items, and then we finally reviewed the whole set and can focus on other content, like more specific draft content and stuff like that. Alright, hope you guys enjoyed it. If you did, please subscribe to the channel, turn on the notification icon to not miss out on future content, and hit the like button. Let me know in the comments what you think. Let me know what you think about the evaluations, where you might disagree or have questions. Always happy for discussion or feedback, and always open to suggestion for future content you guys might like to see, what you would like to learn or hear from me about. And yeah, so let me know in the comment section, and You can also find me on social media over here, Twitter, Facebook, and live streaming on Twitch. I plan on streaming quite a lot of Artifact in the future, so make sure to follow me there if you don't want to miss that. And if you want to support the free content and keep it going, please consider whitelisting YouTube. Turning off your adblock, watching the content really helps me a lot. So yeah, that's it again for today. This was the Artifact set review with the Black Creeps. I'm your host, Manu S. I thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye.